living for what never brings an ounce of peace inside the gap that used to be so big ain't very wide. I guess the ones who get it will be soon laughed out of church. Then again, I suppose they wouldn't be the first. This world and all its charm has made so many men two-faced, but that's not the stuff on which our faith is based. It ought to make a man honest so he don't lie. Ought to change his heart so he ain't after a piece of the pie. Ought to bring contentment with the simple things he's got. If your faith can't do that much, it ain't worth a lot. If your faith can't do that much, it ain't worth a lot. If your faith can't do that stuff, it ain't what you've got.
Supposed to draw people in by singing, but it never works for me. Usually go the other way. I guess I'm supposed to do one more till the roof caves in. Religion's been around since time began. We can't avoid the subject all our lives. When we die, we're going down or taking one cool flight. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Now eternity, from what I hear, don't stop. It's not like it's another 80 years. Once you've landed there, there'll be no end in sight. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Now most folks are fine if all you talk about is heaven. They figure it must have a lake where fishing's good. They bring their cooler full of ice and they're cool Bud Light. Wait a minute, we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. We ought to get it right. It ain't another test in grade school. You can't make it up, we only get one shot. If heaven's real and hell is full, we hadn't better take this light. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Now first of all, heaven ain't no place for sinning. Getting drunk or chasing foolish dreams. You sure won't be at home if all you like to do is fight. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. It ain't a place where folks are always screaming because they won some million-dollar home. I'd hardly think that heaven would be filled with worldly hype. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Our thoughts and prayers are with you, so they say. The sappy story goes with every football game. He's gonna play this one for Jesus, as if God's looking down tonight. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. We ought to get it right. It ain't another test in grade school. We can't make it up, we only get one shot. If heaven's real and hell is full, we hadn't better take this light. We're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Now soldiers' uniforms don't come with built-in halos. can die in service and still end up in hell. God's not impressed with our pride and character, and I don't mean that as a slight. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Fish signs on your car don't make you Christian, and crosses by the highway still don't seal the deal. We sure do love our symbols, but that don't mean we've seen the light. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. It all comes down to if the heart surrendered. Religious practice just don't mean a thing. Jesus said some words, but most of them we all rewrite. We do. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. We ought to get it right. It ain't another test in grade school. Can't make it up, we only get one shot. If heaven's real and hell is full, we hadn't better take this light. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Some guy's been preaching on the radio for decades. Claims he's got the whole thing figured out. Says we need to buy his book, hoping lots of fools will bite. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. Some simple math will tell you, you don't need him. A quick peek in the Bible tells you that. Guys that peddle God for money should be told to take a hike. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. So the next time you see Bozo on your TV with his Bible and bag of magic tricks, you should call in on his prayer line and say, hey, go fly a kite. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. We ought to get it right. It ain't another test in grade school. You can't make it up, we only get one shot. If heaven's real and hell is full, we hadn't better take this light. If we're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right. We're gonna do this thing, we ought to get it right.
All right, if our speakers could come up to the stage, please. Okay, very good. There are some questions that are specifically directed to one of the speakers, and others are, I think, appropriate for all, and they can pass the mic.
I'm on? All right. You get there? Tell us how it's going to work, Rob.
I'm going to ask questions and you're going to answer them.
Excellent.
Is this your first rodeo, Chris?
This is it, man. Just want to make it perfectly clear, yeah. Want to make it perfectly clear, I have all the friends I'll need for the rest of my life, so I did not come here to make any friends.
Okay, testing is okay.
All right, since we have one mic on, I will ask a question, and the question is, what do you think of ecumenical prayer sessions, for example, President's Prayer Breakfast?
You're on, right? You're on too?
I'm here, man.
Okay. Check. You and I are friends.
Well, I volunteer with a government agency of law enforcement, and they've already asked me to not pray in Jesus' name. But fortunately for them, there's other chaplains in this department that have no problem not praying in Jesus' name. So I said, I won't do it. So get these others. This guy believes in Mother Nature. That guy believes over here. You have plenty of pagans you can choose from.
I think the very concept of ecumenical and prayer is an oxymoron. It's a contradiction of terms. I mean, how can you have a Buddhist and a Christian, who are they praying to? And they say they're praying to God. Well, what God? And this is, I think, very apparent in ecumenical meetings of any kind. When the Pope says all religions worship the same God, that would, I guess, to him mean they also pray to God, because he said God is love. It's just part of the confusion that seems to attract people into faith, but it's not biblical faith. It's a faith, not the faith.
Okay, well, I'll throw one in there too. So since we're throwing grenades, I think that God summed it up very nicely when he said that all the other gods were just, they're just dumb idols. So the fact that we should be able to throw our self into the ring with all that stuff and have our speech stifled, and as though we're just kind of the same group, we're not. So interfaith and having them all together is the kind of ecumenism that the Antichrist is going to have a field day with when he shows up. Mm-hmm. The world is being programmed for that, that there are no distinctions. It's the erasing of distinctions. So if we wanted to try to somehow contribute to that, then we're bigger fools than we might think we are.
I agree.
I agree.
Let me add that presently in Canada, I think it's on the books as of this week, that to say anything negative against Islam, it will essentially be a hate crime. But apparently you can say anything you want negative against Christianity, and that doesn't count. So I think some of these so-called ecumenical things are very lopsided and in favor of all belief systems, but not biblical Christianity.
Which tells you who is God is who. Were you going to say that, Chick?
Yeah. I like what you had to say, is that, you know, the compromise, the ones who are keeping true over here, who really loses out? These people never missed out. So I wrote, when they were trying to tell the chaplains not to pray in Jesus' name, and I said, well, we need to have a meeting. Wrote one of the deputy chiefs there who wanted to meet with me. He drew the short straw to talk to me. And I wrote him an email. So, well, before we meet, I just want to let you know, after 160 years of this department being established, there's always been clergy involved and there's always been prayer at these ceremonies. I just want to know, are you going to be the guy who's going to stand before God to say, I'm the assistant chief who canceled prayer in this organization after 160 years? So when he met with me, he said, I don't want to be that guy, I don't want to be that guy, I don't want to be that guy. And I said, well, now we can talk. And so he said, your solution is have other people pray, but as for me and my house, I'm going to serve the Lord, and you get what you have. And then the other people in the department who've heard about that, they might not agree with me that it would be Jesus, but they all agree with me that I've stayed the course and that I'm not compromising, and I get respect for that. Even though they don't like Jesus, they respect me for the stand that I've taken. So I'll go with that.
Next question is, how do you warn the church when it has been shown that they are not interested?
All right, well, none of you guys spoke up. So, really, I get this question. People ask it all the time. I ask them, do you know what the problem is that they're teaching? And once they say yes, then I say, have you brought it to the attention of the leadership? And when they say yes, and then I'm able to say, and they ignored you, right? And they told you that you're the one breaking the unity and you did all that kind of stuff, right? Yes. Find another church.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. I've done the same thing here. I always try to encourage people to do Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 through 17, about confronting and doing those things. It might take months or weeks, but you go through that process, you do that. So when you do leave, you can leave knowing that they chose not to take the warning, but you need to go get plugged in to a fellowship. where they do that. But don't leave until you do that. Just don't say, I disagree. Do everything you can to plead your case and do those things. And hopefully, because that's what the scripture says, you might be able to win them over. And that would be the thing to do. But if they don't want to be won over, well then you need to go get plugged in to where you're going to fit the Word of God. Yep. Yep. Well, you get with the leadership. You know, you do the Matthew chapter 18. I've done that. I'm in the process right now. It's been taking me 3 years. I'm in the process right now, and I'm still trying to get that. I'm trying to get that leadership meeting together, but I'm still hopeful that it'll happen. But for whatever reason, I tend to intimidate people, and they don't want to meet. So, but I'm still trying.
When the leadership in a church ignores the warnings, and the warnings are biblical, it's because they have an agenda of their own that they want to promote. And if you continue warning them, they're just going to get upset and further reject you. So I think what you need to do is address the issue and do it in love.
Amen.
And if there's no response, move on.
But just don't leave. Make sure you make it known and try your best, but yeah, you might not. If they're the ones in charge, you're just going to have to leave, man. And, I mean, that's, you know.
They will usually tell you to leave.
Yeah, they will, yeah.
You don't have to ask any more questions. Usually, by that point, they're not interested in your complaints. Yeah. Move on.
Move on.
That is actually part of the purpose-driven methodology. That is flat out in the owner's manual, if you will. If you got malcontents, get rid of them.
Yep.
Tell them they're not welcomed. Yeah, you got to get them out. So they're breaking the unity.
Usually before that, there's some other symptoms. You'll be shunned by the leadership and the other members of the church. You're told that you're dangerous. And
it's time you need to get out.
So you'll know. But you know, take a stance. Contend for the faith. That's what the Bible says. Contend earnestly. Don't just walk away and say, I'm defeated. But share the truth scripturally as best you can. And you don't necessarily have to write a book, but maybe present some documentation, some literal proof that, hey, I don't like, for example, a certain book presented in women's Bible study that presents a false teaching. And that's all you can do is document it, and if they don't want to listen, move away.
Next question. I'm interested in thoughts concerning how we talk about leaders. Some are deceived. Some are deceivers. Is it okay to call them out? E.g., Ephesians, trickery of men, some crept in unawares.
Yeah. Well, we can jump back into that again. That you kind of did deal with it. There is something that's interesting in the way that was said. Are they genuine deceivers, or are they just themselves deceived? And, you know, sometimes that might be, it's subjective. How do you figure out which is which? That's, you've got to go to them and say, do you really believe this? Do you understand where that's a problem error-wise? But I can guarantee you this. Pastors are some of the most stubborn, egotistical, full of themselves people you will ever see. And how dare you, one of you people sitting out there in the pews, you rubes, who do you know, or what do you know better than I do? So you want to talk about some puffed, up, stiff-necked people, pastors are at the top of that list. How do I know? Check. So,
hey, barely. No. Bear witness.
They're Pharisees and Sadducees. And you know why they're sad.
Because they're sad, you see. So they're, that is one of the, you got to be ready for that. And with all the kidding aside, if you're in that kind of a situation, just again, it is really, really hard to find a guy who's humble enough to be shown something in the scripture where they're wrong and then accept it. That is not an easy thing to find, because humility, unfortunately, around most pastors, took a dirt nap the day that they took the position.
There's been a portion of Scripture that's been helpful to me. And Paul is writing Timothy. This is 2 Timothy chapter 2, and beginning verse 23. But refuse foolish and ignorant speculations, knowing that they produce quarrels. The Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wronged, with gentleness, correcting those who are in opposition. If perhaps God may grant them repentance, leading to the knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. So, you know, we're in a battle, spiritual battle, and of course pastors in the same battle, and many of them have been caught in the deception by the snare of the devil. And I think to go to them and be hostile isn't going to be the way that you're going to reach them. You have to do it humbly, gently, in love, but tell them the truth. And, you know, peradventure, the King James says, God may deliver them, or perchance they may be delivered from Satan's snare, from the trap that they've been caught in. So, you know, over the years, I've seen some that have responded to biblical truth, but many that have not. And usually when they reject the truth, they go further and further the other direction. And like Pastor Chris says, there is essentially a lot of pride involved, and pride is a great barrier to the truth.
Agreed.
This question's for Paul Smith. What do you do if your pastor tells a lot of stories but doesn't seem to focus on the Word of God, and you live in a small town?
You move to a larger town, I guess. start a church. In other words, go for truth. And yet you can leave a testimony, and how precious that is, that you can live a life. And God will have you, maybe he has you in that place where you can begin a work that God will bless. Yeah.
All right, this one is relatively long. It's written to Chris. It says that you said, quoting Chris, "It is my personal contention that if a person holds a proper eschatological view, they will have to see God's future plan for the nation of Israel. They would never want to be subversive or sway opinion otherwise." And then it continues on, but then their question is, "My question would be, if considered, can leaders truly warn the church and encourage them to understand the times in order to contend for the faith if they themselves violate the principle that you stated and also demonstrably live by? A second part, and perhaps a follow-up to that question, would be, if we exclude eschatology as non-essential, how does one do this and at the same time emphasize that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine?"
Complicated question. If you guys didn't understand how it was phrased, the point is, if you have the view, when you hear eschatology, it's the study of end things, and if you believe and you teach over the pulpit that Israel doesn't have a rightful doesn't have a right to the land, that it wasn't what God gave them, and you're teaching what we call replacement theology, that the church has now adopted all of the promises made to Israel because they forfeited them by rejecting Messiah and all that nonsense, I don't care what you say your eschatology is. If you believe that about Israel, I can't trust you on anything, because to me, you are, oh my goodness, the level of violence you have to do to the text to buy into that nonsense, especially if you're looking at the Old Testament. And so whenever that comes up around here, I'll always say it this way. Look, you will find repeatedly where God says that he's going to rejoin Israel and Judah. Israel was taken out by the Assyrians and never seen afterwards. So they had been displaced from the land way before the Babylonian captivity, and they came back from that captivity only to be basically dispersed when God was done with them. So He said that he's going to reestablish them. So to anyone who would say that the church has replaced Israel, I would have to say, please then show me where God did exactly what he said he was going to do historically. Has it ever happened anywhere historically? And if you're going to try to tell me that it's a metaphor for the church, then you just lost me. At that point, I'm going to turn around and just walk away, because that's just rank ignorance. So that's because you bought into whatever theological view you were taught from someone else, but that just isn't what the scripture teaches. So whatever you're going to draw as a conclusion in eschatology from that point on, if you begin with a false premise, like with math, anybody really good with math here? If you're going to do long division or long addition or, you know, something really basic like me, 1 plus 1 is 2 and 2 plus 2 is 4. If I get 1 plus 1 is 3, everything after that's wrong. Right? Correct? Same situation here. If you're wrong on Israel, your eschatology is going to be messed up. So you could say it this way. Bad eschatology leads to bad doctrine. So then the second part of it was? Anybody want to jump in while he's reading that?
The second part was, if we exclude eschatology as non-essential, how does one do this and at the same time emphasize that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and right?
Yeah, those two are, they're, yeah, you cannot divorce one from the other. If you believe that all Scripture is given and you're going to say we shouldn't bother with eschatology, you're a walking contradiction. So, honestly, I know this will probably get me in trouble with some people. If I hear a pastor say, I'm not going to talk about eschatology because it's too divisive and too many people have different opinions about it, but if all Scripture is given, then that man's a coward. A coward. He's afraid.
Coward. Yeah, it came across
not willing
a mic
to take a
like
stand.
That man's a cow, and that didn't make sense. Coward. A coward
makes sense. Yeah, voice. That man's a cow. I don't think that works, though.
Have a cow. I think that works.
Anybody else want to jump in?
No, that's good. That's good.
The next one is a combination of two questions. I'm combining them because they're similar. What are we to do with people like Greg Laurie and Billy Graham, who clearly preach the gospel, but associate with well-known false teachers and false churches, such as Rick Warren?
Who wants to take it first?
Oh, I will jump in on this because I got saved through Greg's ministry. So I'll go last here. Yeah. You want to take it?
I love these men. In other words, and I believe that they're men that have been called of God to a ministry. I believe that oftentimes changes are made in ministry and with pastors. And what concerns me is when we begin to add too many of these man's way of doing something rather than trusting God to do his work and to do his convictions and to, by the Holy Spirit, convict of sin, of righteousness, and judgment to come. And I think that when I became involved with these different crusades and meeting with the Grahams, meeting with Greg Laurie, and loving them. In other words, Greg, actually, when he became a believer, he began to study Billy Graham and Billy Graham's way. Through the whole process, when we had that one meeting, when Chuck was asked to be at Anaheim Stadium, and Greg had his, I think it was the 30th year, or 20th or 30th, but it was after he'd been evangelizing, doing a great job. We were in the place there where the players come in the long hall, and you get in, and here's where they, the ball players, they're in their dugout, and we would have nice things like we had here, food that was available and things like that. But what happened was Greg came in all out of breath. Rick Warren was right on his tail. And he said, Chuck. He had asked Chuck to open in prayer because it was his anniversary and so forth. And Chuck, he said, Rick Warren is here. Could you introduce him and ask him to pray? Well, we were just ready to go out on the field and take our position there on the stage. And then the way that they have they train the people at Calvary, some of you are familiar with how they would come and they would tell them, give them the things to take, and they would all head out of their seats to encourage others who were not believers. They would see all of these getting up and going down front, forward. Anyway, I felt like things had become more of a show than that genuineness that I felt is necessary if we're going to be servants of a God who is in control of everything. And so if you'll note, there's a picture, and they kept trying to get a picture of Greg kept leaning over and waving over at the side to the right-hand side where we came out of the dugout. And Rick Warren was doing the same thing, waving toward where Chuck was sitting because they wanted a picture. They wanted to capture Chuck supporting something that was staged. And my brother, just don't do that. In other words, it's not a stage that we're trying to do. We're trying to do what God has called us to be and to do. And I think that man's way and God's way are two different things with so many people. And we all make mistakes. But I think we need to, when we see the error of what we're doing, then we don't do it again and again and again and again and again, because it works, because it brings a crowd, and we'll make a show. Let God put on the show, and let him do his thing, his way. I'm sorry, but I'm
That's
just...
That's great.
Good.
You're good?
Does it make sense?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. We don't work with Harvest Crusade, and haven't done that for years. And every time they call or email, I make sure I let them know we have no use for that ministry here. We're doing fine with what we're doing. We believe in the personal witness of all believers. The same thing I've always told my kids, if you talk to any one of my kids, I always said, I'm so proud of my kids so far. And I don't really give out my name for endorsements for things. Because someone will call up and say, hey, you had this band play there, and they use you as an endorsement. Do you still recommend them? I did when they were here. I don't know what they're doing now. It's not a once and for all thing. So yeah. When they were here, yeah, but I don't know what they're doing. So, no, I don't always. So you just have to be careful with that. But when I saw that whole thing happening with the new Azusa Street, Lou Engle, and things happening at the Coliseum, and all that stuff was hitting the news, and people in my congregation back in St. Paul are seeing this. For the most part, we were just grateful that we weren't a part of any of that, and go from there. So, but you got to do as the Lord leads you. The Lord's led us to not be a part of that. And known Greg years ago, and I don't recognize him today.
Well, Rick Warren has a saying, it's not all about you. But it seems to be all about him. And my question would be to CCA, which have made a separation from Calvary Costa Mesa, is they should clarify some of the issues. For example, the photo op at Chuck's memorial with Rick Warren on the platform. I think a lot of people are still asking the question, what was that about?
Yeah.
Rick Warren was never really a spokesperson for the Calvary Chapel movement while Chuck was alive. So what about now? It's not all about numbers. But it seems that Rick Warren is part of the Peter Drucker model that it is about numbers. And I would like to see Calvary Chapel get away from following after any man and get back to following Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd.
Yeah. We, my wife and I, got saved through Greg's ministry back in 85. And we're only willing to drive out to Riverside for about 5 months. And then a friend of mine invited me here. Truth be known, I hated this place the first time I walked in because I was so used to the big show. And for years and years, we were involved, like Chick had mentioned, we were involved heavily with Harvest Crusades. Where it really kind of changed with us and why we don't have anything to do with it anymore, it used to be that the follow-up counseling was done through Calvary Chapels, so we would know what was being done doctrinally. We started to see people, brand new believers, be sent to churches that I would cringe if my families went to as new believers. And that was enough. It wasn't personal. It's nothing else. I just don't bear witness with the ministry. So has Greg's message changed? Not from what I've heard. He still seems to be as solid in what he teaches. That's not the problem. The association's confusion, crazy amounts of confusion. So, you know, we mentioned a little bit about Rick Warren. Maybe some of you have noticed just this last week that Rick Warren has been added to the K-Wave roster of speakers, of teaching. So he has, I think, a 4:30 in the morning slot and 11 at night or something like that. And Brian defended him by saying, look, he's theologically sound. And he put up on, I think, his Facebook page, Rick Warren being interviewed by John Piper. And so, all right, great. Well, see, if you want to know what he's teaching, don't look at what he said to John Piper, because he would have told John Piper what he wanted to hear. Listen to his show. You want to see what he's teaching? You want to see if there's value to it as far as the gospel's concerned? Listen to the show. Rick Warren may be a great guy. I've never met him, but he's devoid of a clear expression of the gospel, period. There's just nothing more to it. And he's not a careful Bible teacher. So, you know, associations mean an awful lot. And I know that there are people that looking at this and hearing me say that. Associations mean a lot. Looking at me standing or sitting next to these guys here, I will not be ashamed of sitting next to these guys. We're of like mind. But we jokingly said that we could call this conference the Understand the Times 2017, or we could also be called the Postmodern Church Basket of Deplorables. So so we won't win a popularity contest, but that's okay.
Amen.
Okay, a little easier question. What is wrong with Calvinism?
There's absolutely nothing you can do about it. It's been interesting. I'll tell you this. My son couldn't play instruments really well, one of my kids, and so he started a rock band with another kid in church, and just so they could get into the underground scene and preach the gospel, and they were actually getting really good, and a lot of these secular bands were having them, and they would go there and they'd preach the gospel. But the band kept getting tore apart because they kept getting Calvinist kids. I'm from the Twin Cities area, so that's where John Piper's from, and everyone just keeps quoting John Piper. So my son just tore into all my study books and things on Calvinism. He's like, Pops, you see, this is crazy. And he kept, what's wrong with them? What's wrong with this? And so they brought in, and he had all his John Piper books, and he had all his quotes, and they brought in a band member. And he said, why are you in this band? Well, preach the gospel. And he goes, but you don't believe in altar calls or salvation. He goes, well, no, I don't, but I need to occupy till the Lord comes. And I got to do this. And he says, okay. He says, well, listen, we're not firing you. I just want you to understand, so you can't get upset, you can't get on Facebook. It's been preordained before the foundations of the world that you would not be in this band. There's nothing we can do. I mean, we want you. If we had a choice, we would have you in this band. And then he started to say, but as John Piper says, because the guy kept putting money. He did all this stuff, and the guy said, "You're firing me." No, if we had a choice, we don't have a choice. So, and he just took all his quotes and all the things and everything like that, and so he just used his own logic on him. So there was nothing. So it just doesn't make sense. So.
Look at the standard bearers of Reformed theology, not just Calvinism, because most of the typical guys that put themselves in the Reformed camp, guys like Piper or Sproul or any of the rest of them, who hold a lot of what Calvinist views would be, they slap his name on it, but most Reformers believe much of the same kind of stuff. And what you'll notice is that a lot of it is indistinguishable from Catholicism. Whether it is the cessation of the gifts of the Spirit, whether it is the replacement view of Israel, whether it's the amillennial view of eschatology, the preterist view of the book of Revelation. I mean, they have very much the same beliefs, and that shouldn't surprise anybody because many of those reformers came out of Catholicism. They overthrew what they believed of Romanism and the papacy and all the rest of that, but much of their doctrine is exactly the same. Test me on that. Go check it out for yourself. Find out what Catholicism believes on all of those major theological views, and you'll notice they do all the way down to infant baptism and all the rest of it. So, you know, it's what's wrong with Calvinism? I don't want to pick a fight with Calvinism. I have a problem with a lot of what Reformed doctrine teaches, and they would have problems with what I teach. Therefore, how do I have unity with them?
John Calvin's mentor was Augustine. One of the so-called founding fathers of the Roman Catholic Church, who brought in the sacrament of the Eucharist and other sacraments. So that's a question that I have. There is a connection, Les Chris said. Cool.
He was gonna answer that last question because I see we're at the time. Are we not?
Yeah, it's 5:00.
Okay, what time are we supposed to break? 5:15? 5:10? Okay. I know Paul was going to take that question on the contingency thing. So if you have another short one, then we can have him in with that.
That one was... for Paul Smith, what happened with the contingency plan for Calvary Chapel of Costa Mesa that you discussed? Why didn't it happen?
The contingency plan was when Chuck, Kay, and a couple others and myself, along with Ina, who Brian and Cheryl had hired to be Kay's nurse in the home, and she was really the one who kept Brian and Cheryl informed as to everybody that came into Chuck's home. Chuck had asked me to come down to spend a couple months when he was ill, wanted to make sure that we have God's replacement at Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa. And Kay, Chuck, and we spoke about the fact that Brian and Cheryl were not the ones to be involved in leading Calvary Chapel of Costa Mesa. And so we had Ina had reported to Brian and Cheryl, and Cheryl then told someone, some church people, and board members that Chuck had the same problem that Kay had, dementia. And so Chuck's personal attorney asked if I, Paul, she said, I'm going to prepare a paper that I want the doctors to sign that Chuck does not have dementia, that Chuck is fully capable of decision making, and he's healthy in his mind and all, and there's nothing wrong with Pastor Chuck. Now, his daughter had accused him of having dementia and said that, and this was being promoted with the board at Calvary. And so this was now about the fifth time that Brian had insisted that he was going to be taking over Calvary Chapel. And this is after being in London for 4.5 years, and when he returned home. I know you were on the board at the time, and in fact, I think you were in one of the meetings that we had. I had two board members in a meeting with Chuck and myself, and two board meetings. Immediately, I went out the next day with papers from the attorney to have the doctors that were treating Chuck from Hogue Hospital to make it very clear that Chuck was of sound mind. There was nothing wrong with Chuck's mind that he, and anyway, I had those papers signed. I still have the original signed papers. And so we realized that we needed someone who understood Calvary and the heart of Calvary Chapel. One of the main things that sort of disturbs me a little is the fact that one of the main issues of Calvary Chapel, and one of the things that I feel that God had blessed and used in a wonderful way, was the fact that Chuck insisted that no one was to be put above another, that there was not to be a boss of Calvary Chapel. The Holy Spirit was going to be directing the ministry of Calvary. And its uniqueness, he felt, and this ministry that God gave, a worldwide ministry that covered every continent in the United States, and people were wondering, how could this be? It was only one answer, and that was, it was God's time to do something very special before his return. And so we prepared this contingency plan, and it was going to give Brian and Cheryl, I had a short statement thanking Brian for his work at Calvary Chapel, but that we felt that neither he nor Cheryl were the ones to be directing Calvary Chapel. And so you didn't know it, but you were one of the elders that were involved in contributing to that. We had a meeting as you were there, we wrote out this to where Chuck would not have to confront his daughter, whom he loved very much, and yet he was concerned about the things that she was saying, that she was, anyway, she wanted to be an Amy McPherson, and they thought that Calvary was her thing. And these are just very, very personal things that maybe I shouldn't even be saying, but I do feel that it's vitally important to know that we wanted to take care of Brian and Cheryl and give them a soft landing. And when when Chuck asked me to come down for the last 2 months of his life, and they gave me a bedroom in their home, and we would get up at 4 a.m, we would spend time talking together and sharing about the future of Calvary Chapel, and wanting to know, God, we need your answer. And it was something that there was a great deal of prayer. Both Chuck and I would wake up at about 4 a.m, and when we finally got the plan together, and this plan called for we wanted Chuck to identify 6 or more people, and we had a list. He had gone to 12 of men that he felt that would be effective ministers to continue the work that God had ordained for Calvary Chapel Church. And so those were the things that were in the contingency plan, and Chuck was not. It was just a thank you to Brian for sharing at Calvary, but we did not, in other words, we, anyway. My wife, then, she met with Chuck, and she was quite concerned that Chuck was having me come back. And she said, Chuck, I want to know why you've invited Paul to come back to Calvary Costa Mesa, because he had been removed from CCOF and so forth. And Chuck, in answering Ruth, she kept bugging me about my being spending so much time in Costa Mesa and leaving her on the desert by herself. So we got her a cute little dog and that took my place. And as she came down, I said, honey, I want you to talk to Chuck. I'm going to bow out, and I want you to ask him why he wants me to come back. And so we went in his office, just Ruth, Chuck, and myself. And I was quietly sitting in a chair by myself, and Ruth was sitting there right in front of Chuck's desk, Chuck sitting behind the desk. And by the way, there were about five times that Brian informed Chuck that he was taking over. He did the same with Romaine, and he made stories about Romaine. He said the same things that he said about Romaine, about Paul, about me. And I said, hey, I don't mind being a Romaine. I appreciated Romaine and the calling that he had in serving a ministry that God had expanded and used for his glory. So Ruth had said, Chuck, why have you asked Paul to come down to Costa Mesa again? I must know. He has never left your side, and he's available, and you know he's been available since they were brothers together as kids growing up. And so he said, Ruth, I'm asking Chuck, Paul, to come down because I want him to create an explosion. He says his coming down will create an explosion. And he says, I'm ready for it. We need it. And so she said, well, when Roger Wing and Brian and the Word for Today board fired Paul, she said that I just could not understand that. And for him to come back, I just don't want that to happen again. And so, we had this contingency plan that provided a retirement for Brian and Cheryl, but that they would not continue, they would not be the ones to be pastoring Calvary Costa Mesa. And so that contingency plan was drafted. I forget how many pages we had. I had in there the signatures of the doctors who had been treating Chuck. There was another doctor in Los Angeles that had dealt with another brother from Calvary Chapel, a layman, and his wife had the same issues that Chuck had. And this doctor asked this gentleman to take all of the health issues that Chuck had and just prepare them, which Chuck did, or what this fellow did. Jeff was his name, not Jeff Smith, but another Jeff. And so the doctor said, I can help him. and his life can be extended at least 2, 3, 6 months. The meeting that Chuck and Ruth and I had was in his office, and then that plan was drafted. We put it in Chuck's desk. He said, "Put that right here," and it was at a desk that went off of his desk, and a top drawer where he kept things, files that I would give him files every week about different things that were happening. He knew everything that I knew about letters and over 90 papers from the UK and Europe about the things that were happening there that were not Calvary Chapel and things that they were engaged in. There was a lot of quietness and secrecy with these things, but coming to this plan, we did not want Chuck to have to deal directly with Cheryl and Brian, then there were other things that happened. At the day that Chuck died, I had gone home. I told Chuck, I said, "Chuck, I'm not a Romaine." I said, "You're going to have to speak to these issues, and you have to speak to your board and let them know exactly your feelings." But Chuck had sort of withdrawn from the board because the board, he wanted them to be the ones to make the decisions and do the various things. There wasn't that. Anyway, how do I end this? I'm just wanting to say that God has a plan yet, and he's got a greater plan. And the only thing that I could figure in my heart was that God wanted to cleanse his church. He wanted to purify and get it on target. And that happens. It needs to happen in each of our lives. I'm a sinner. I've been saved by grace. And I make mistakes. We all make mistakes. And Brian has made mistakes. Cheryl has made mistakes. We all have made mistakes. But we need to pray for one another. We need to be able to just ask God to do his work. And so I'm still praying. And I want to see God do his work and revive us again. Fill each heart with your love. May soul be rekindled with fire from above. It's going to take the Holy Spirit to intervene on behalf of God's church today. And there's no other answer but seeking his purpose and his plan and his will and be part of it.
Amen. Why don't you pray to that end?
We got a break for dinner, but I would want to challenge any of you, if you have any questions about it, for them to say that Chuck was suffering from dementia. Go back and listen to the last couple of months of his Sunday mornings, and you tell me whether that's dementia. They have said the same thing about Paul, and people with dementia don't have that level of recall. And if you have heard him, any of you who have heard him, he's told that same story for the last 3 years, and it's always the same one. So it's an easy way to dismiss somebody by just saying they're senile, they have dementia, anything they can throw out there instantly dismisses the person who is saying it. But again, you've heard that. So I would say go and look at what happens when a person genuinely has dementia. They don't do that, and they don't do what Chuck did before he went to be with the Lord. So that's just pretty, honestly, that is sowing dishonesty. That's just flat out lying, it's done for an intent, and the intent is to try to dismiss anything that these people are saying. So you can take that for what it's worth.
Can Paul pray for us while we go to dinner?
Oh,
why don't you close
our
session in prayer, brother?
Heavenly Father, what a joy it is to be together today. And wherever two or three are gathered together, we thank you for coming and being in our midst with us. My prayer is, Lord, that each one of us will fulfill the purpose for which you've given us life. And we thank you that you brought us into the world and you've preserved us and you've kept us. And I pray for each one here tonight. I pray that your love will just fill our hearts. We pray that you'll bless the food that's shared and other things tonight. We pray that you'll just get glory from this, and may this be a beautiful turning point in your working in the world today before your return. Our desire is, Lord, that the that last beautiful supper that it'll be filled with many who come in these last moments of before your return, before the rapture of the church. We're looking forward to that great event, Lord. And come tonight if you want. I'd be happy. In Jesus' name, amen.
I just want to make a short announcement before we depart. Tonight, Trevor is going to do a mini concert, which means he's going to do what he was doing today, only in one chunk. And I'm going to give him a few more minutes than it was scheduled, because I'm going to cut down my presentation. And it's not going to be titled Contending for the Faith. We've gone through a lot of issues today dealing with current trends. And what I want to share with you is really the passion of my heart, which is the Bryce Holmes International Program for children around the world. That we now have over 100 Bryce Homes in 8 countries and about 500 children. And I just want to share you some clips, video clips, and the basic concept of the program to show you that understand the times in itself is not just in a ministry that it attacks and, you know, exposes the news, but we also have a passion and compassion for the lost and the poor.
Okay, we're supposed to be back here at 6:30. We're getting out of here about 10 minutes later than we had planned, so we'll be a little bit flexible on that. But if you can get back as close to 6:30 as possible, enjoy. If you didn't, if you're looking for a place to eat and you didn't go do it, and you still want to know about places, come and see me.